Rick, there's a lot of truth to what Rick just said, especially about my wife. I would definitely agree with him that my wife is very smart and smarter than me. You are. Anyway, listen, there's so many times, Kristen and I do a lot of marriage counseling, and of course, she, like Rick said, she runs the counseling ministry, and there's many times where I will throw stuff at Kristen and say, hey, listen, I was talking to somebody about some stuff, marriage, things like this, give me some thoughts on that, and she just starts throwing stuff at me, really good stuff, and I'm like, wow, I've never thought about it that way, and just even when she starts explaining things, especially when it comes to like how our brain works and all this stuff. And I'm like, that is really cool to know. That's stuff I've never thought about, especially in counseling. So we love to counsel, and a lot of times it's kind of like, I'm the pastor going, hey, here's what I think. Let's look at the Bible and see what it says. Of course, she says, hey, this is what the Bible says too, but let me give you some other thoughts on some of this stuff too. So we'll bounce off a lot of ideas and thoughts to couples and encourage them. So we thought tonight, especially with the topic for the specifically commitment number 5, it says we will deal with our differences with appreciation and grace. And as we started thinking about differences and the differences that we have with each other, I was like, this would be a great chance to ask my wife to join us. So we're going to I'm going to share some things, she's going to share some things, specifically with commitment number 5. And our prayer is that this will encourage you, that this will challenge you as we look at these things. So, with that in mind, we did want to look at commitment number 5. We're going to walk through Paul Tripp's book, some of those points, but again, we're going to kind of add some stuff to it, some thoughts that we've had with this, and praying through this, and thinking through this. We've been married close to 30 years. It'll be actually 30 years this summer, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. So anyway, I say that to say thank you. We just walked through a lot in our life. We grew up at Hickory Grove Baptist Church. Since I was 2 years old. She came when she was like, how old were you?
I was in seventh grade.
Seventh grade, okay. So we started like dating at that point, a couple of years later.
Well, our dates consisted of him coming over to our house, my parents' house, and getting to hang out with my mom and dad.
Yes,
brother,
that's
sister.
Right. So, but we officially went on our first date when she turned 16, you know how that goes anyway. So that's what we did, but, and then we just dated for a while, and then we got married. I mean, she was like 20 years old, I was 22. We got married here at Hickory Grove Baptist Church, and then I said, hey, let's go to seminary out in Texas.
I was like, woo!
Yeah, and so we went to Texas, enjoyed 2 years out there, and somehow God brought us back to Hickory Grove, and we're here now. So anyway, that's a quick picture of our life when we first got married, and it was great for us to kind of get away from our families for those first 2 years. It's you know, that was just good for us, kind of made us kind of rely on each other even more because we didn't have the parents there. And that was helpful. But again, God brought us back and has just taught us so much through the last 30 years of our life through different situations. And so we're different. And that's what we're talking about initially tonight, is just looking at differences. And the first thing we're going to look at is just how we're created different. How we are created different in our life. So what we're going to do is we're going to jump into Genesis chapter 1. And this is a great passage to go back. And this is what Paul Tripp does. He does look in Genesis chapter 1. And I'll tell you this, in studying and looking at the doctrine of marriage and that aspect of what the Bible says about marriage, it's always great to look back at Genesis chapter 1, 2, and actually even chapter 3 of Genesis. And that's what we're going to do tonight. Now, most of you, when you had your wedding ceremony, probably one of the verses, or if you're getting ready to get married, the one of the verses you might use in where the pastor stands up and reads the scripture is Genesis chapter 2, where it talks about, you know, hey, it's not good for man to be alone, so he created woman, and then the whole thing of therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, they shall hold fast, they shall become one flesh. So you've heard that verse. Well, let's go back in Genesis chapter 1, one chapter back, and look at a passage that you're very familiar with. It's Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. And it says this, then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. Verse 27, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female. So we were created, and we know this. This is just simple stuff that you're aware of, that you know of. We were created in His image. Somehow, we were like God. And we're different, obviously, than animals. And it says it right there. It goes into the scripture and talks about that. He created male and female. And so in looking at the context of marriage, as we're a male and a female, we start looking at the differences. You think about this, how God, in His creative mind, created every single person and how we were created very uniquely. So men, I want you to think about your wife. I want you to think about your wife and remember this. Everything that makes up your wife, the way she looks, her gifts, her particular personality, all that came from God, right? So that's what you got to remember there. Ladies, now look at your husband, look at your the person you might be getting ready, or you're getting ready to get married to, and realize this. Everything that makes up your husband, what he looks like, just like I said, his gifts, his personality, came out of the mind of God. Now, we're going to kind of come back to that and camp on that a little bit, because that's something that sometimes we fly by. And when we start thinking about our marriages and stuff, that's something we don't go back to as a foundational piece. Hey, God created us. And so think about this, your physical attributes, your hair, and this is where Paul Tripp just kind of starts listing things. He talks about the hair color, eye color, body shape, jaws, noses, foreheads, ears, chins, lips, teeth, height, all from God. And then think about your gifts and abilities. I mean, your gifts and abilities that you have, God gave it to you. Those thoughts, the mechanical, analytical, conceptual, mathematical, organizational, artistic, all those things, God gave those to you. And even your personality. Now, some of you married your husband, you married your wife, and you're like, man, they're such an extrovert, and I'm an introvert. Or they're loud, I'm quiet. You know, there's some things that God just designed you the way you are. So you start thinking about that, what God designed. Before you were born, this is who you are. This is what God did. So in thinking about that, you start going, okay, then I was born. I'm here. Now, what happened from that point of birth and when you met your spouse, all those things that even made you more different? And Krista, you're going to kind of talk about that a little bit.
Yeah.
Share a little bit with that.
Yeah, so our genetics do make us very different, but also the events that happen in our life make us very different as well. Like, for example, every event that happens to you, whether it's good or whether it's bad, it changes your brain structure. So everything that happens to you, it changes how you think, how you are. It changes everything about you. It also changes your nervous system, whether you can tolerate anxiety, whether you can not tolerate it. It changes you to the genetic core of who you are. So events are really important. Now, a couple of examples of this is like the culture you grew up in. Now, the culture you grew up in will determine how you look at parenting, how you look at holidays, how you celebrate holidays or big events in your life, how you look at safety or not feeling safe. So how you grew up will determine that. Attachment patterns with your parents, specifically your mother, will determine how you attach to other people. And so that it to your core, it changes who you are. So you may have been born with all of this, but as you grow and as you attach and as you learn safety or not safety, then it changes who you are and who you could be and who you might be, and it changes how you attach to the person that you are married to. Also trauma, if you've experienced trauma, if you have experienced really hard things in your life, then that also changes who you are. It changes, and you're going to hear me say this a lot, safety. It changes how you view safety. And you heard Kyler talk about trust last week. So trust is safety. And so if you feel like the world is not safe, then it determines how you connect to your spouse. So as you can see, there's a lot of things that go into making you different and making things hard or easy in your marriage.
And most of the time what it is, and you guys know this, it's almost like as you start looking at the differences in your life, in your marriage, you start going, oh, wait, this is probably why we struggle in some areas in our marriage. Now listen, if you are engaged, you know, you've dated and now you're engaged, there's a good chance that what drew you to each other is your differences. You know what I'm saying? You're kind of like, you know, we've gone out some and I like you because, you know, it feels like we just kind of, we're different enough that if we come together, we're just going to be a perfect, you know, our differences are going to just be perfect and it's going to make us just one. And when that whole thing flesh come together, man, look at us, you know, this is just how it's going to work. For those of you who have been married now, if you've been married for a year, you're starting to go, oh, wait, this is not exactly what I thought. I mean, I thought our differences were going to bring us together. I mean, you're different than me, and you're not changing your ways for me, and I want you to be this way. You start looking at it that way. Now, for those of you who've been married for much longer, you're either, like one or two camps, you're either going, you know what, we're definitely looking at this, and we understand that there's some differences, and we are working on this. We're working through how we can complement each other even better. Now, some of you are probably out there doing this. You've gotten to the point somewhere in your marriage that you went, man, we're different, and we fight about these differences, and we're still dealing with this. We've been married for 10, 15 years, and we're still dealing with it, and we don't know what to do, so we're just kind of going, okay, we're married, but we're not going to deal with that. I think that's what happens a lot of times in marriages is we see that. It's just you get to the point where you're like, I don't want to deal with the difference. So this being different is huge, and so we can't ignore it, though, and this is what the great thing about Paul Tripp, what he goes through, is saying, listen, you've got to look at your differences and realize what those differences are, and then say, hey, you know what? We've got to work this together. So that's what we're going to kind of look at is dealing with differences, just dealing with differences. So one of the things Paul Tripp does is he goes through, he just lays it out as kind of like a biblical plan in dealing with your difference. So that's the first thing we're going to look at here is just looking at this biblical plan to face our differences. First thing is this, and you can write this down, and this is in your book, but we'll just kind of give a good few points here. Number one. And this is the one I'm going to camp out on a little bit more because this is very interesting. Paul Tripp says, God is in absolute control of the details of our lives. God is in absolute control of the details of our lives. Now, what that means is this. God is in control, was in control of the family you were born in, where you were born, where you would live, your background, and how that shaped your desires, your thinking, your acting, your responding, who you married, God was in control of that. He wrote your stories, each of you. I mean, just where you came from, God was writing that. God was making things happen. God is a sovereign, the providence of God bringing you together. And when you came together, now this is, I'm going to say this more for those that have been married for a while. When you came together, and then you're like, man, over the past 15 years in our marriage, this is what's gone on and this is what's happened and there's been some chaos there, especially through our differences, again, these struggles. It's almost like we sometimes think that God is orchestrating everything. We believe in God. We're Christians. We're here and we're like, man, this is what we believe about God. We worship God. But a lot of times when it comes to marriage, it's almost like, man, I'm dealing with this stuff in my marriage and God is like stepped back and he's just kind of looking at it going, okay, what are you going to do? Hey, you know what? You failed doing this. You didn't do this right. I think that's what we think sometimes that God is doing to us. And so we back off. But listen, God is right there in the midst of everything that's happening in your marriage. Everything. That's the God we serve. And you think about that, and it's almost like that's hard to grasp. That God knows exactly what's happening. Everything that's happened in your life, first of all, but in your marriage, in the context of what we're talking about, God is there. He's not surprised. He's not going, oh, whoa, what just happened in your marriage? Oh, man, I'm surprised. I can't believe you're doing what? That's how we think God is thinking about our marriage. According to Scripture, that's not what God's doing. God is involved in our lives. I mean, you think about the sovereignty of God. God is not sitting back and watching your life, and he is involved in it. Listen to this, just a few verses. Hebrews 1, verse 3 says this, he is the radiance of the glory of God, the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. Remember how powerful God is. God is involved. Colossians 1:17, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Ephesians 1:11, in him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to his will. God is working in your marriage. And then the last one is this, just a verse, Psalm 139, 16. It says this, Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me when as yet there was none of them. God was planning your days. God is planning your days before you were even born. Now, again, we know that. We hear that scripture. But again, put it in the context of your marriage. God is in there. He's working in your differences. He knows what's going on. So, listen, sometimes in marriage, now, for those of you who are engaged and getting ready to get married, you don't necessarily want to listen to this, but this is the truth. Sometimes you get in marriage and you kind of go, I mean, it could be a few years into it, and you go, oh, whoa, what's going on here? I mean, maybe a week after you got married, did I make the right decision here? I mean, you start thinking things. You're like, did I do this right? I mean, gosh, we're already fighting. What's going on here in our marriage? But a year, 2 years, 5 years into it, man, God, you start thinking about, did I make mistakes doing this and that? Listen, that's wrong thought. We think it, but we got to go, man, God is in control. God is in our marriage and everything. The second thing he talks about is this. Paul Tripp says, he has a purpose for the situations and locations in which he places us. So we say, well, okay, I thought when I got married that I was supposed to be happy. I mean, that's one of the reasons I'm married or getting married is because I want to be happier. I mean, I was single, and now I've got somebody, I want to get married, and I want to be happy because, right, that's what we're supposed to be, is happy. By the way, your primary purpose of your marriage is not to be happy. Now, some people, I've said that before, and some people are like, well, you know, God wants us to be happy. That's not the primary purpose of your marriage. The primary purpose of your marriage is for God's glory. God's going to allow us to struggle in our differences. And that's where we say, why would God do that? That can kind of go back to your own personal walk with God. Why am I struggling in life with things? Is that because I'm not doing something right and God's leading you, God's allowing this, God's orchestrating this stuff to bring glory to Him, to work in our life, a sanctification process. Just as we look at our own lives, you guys should know this, personally as a Christian, I'm walking in this in my relationship with Christ. I struggle with things. God is working in your life to sanctify you, to bring you, to make you more holy. So now take that whole idea and put it in the context of your marriage. That's what's happening. God is using your marriage for His glory. That's what He wants to do. And so He's sanctifying you. He's taking you through that. He's growing you. And then number three, Paul just says, he says, marriage is one God's primary tools of personal change and growth. So he just lays it out and says, listen, your marriage is there. It's a primary tool for personal change and growth. Number four, three main tools of difference are used to reveal and change our hearts. And those three things are this. The first two we've already talked about. One of them is just, hey, God, the way God created you, before you were born, the things He instilled in you, the creativeness of God, that's one thing. The second thing is what Krista talked about, is your background, just looking at that and saying, man, God has used that to change you and equip you. But the third thing is just, listen, we all still deal with personal sin in our life. So Paul Tripp talks about the whole idea of things in your life, personal sin is there, and it's on a journey to make you more Christ-like. It's to help you grow and mature in your walk with Christ. So it's that idea of, listen, some of you are going to be different levels in your walk with the Lord. And again, that's something that's different, right? You might look at your spouse and say, man, my spouse is just not where I want them to be in their walk with the Lord. That's okay. You're walking in grace, and we're going to talk about that in a few minutes. Grace, we're going to look at that. So it's those things, as Paul Tripp talks about. Number five is this. We'll look at these real quick. Change begins when you see these differences as grace rather than an obstruction of grace. It's walking in it in grace. Look at your differences and look at it. This was it. God gave this to us. This is what He's doing. He's orchestrating it. Number six is just simple. He says, God is with you in your struggle. God is in the middle of the details of your marriage. So he talks about that. This is a biblical model. And then he kind of goes into the whole thing of how do you strengthen unity in your marriage? The goal is unity. Well, how are you different? And how can you become unified if you are different? Krista, you got some thoughts on this.
Yeah, so the next question we're going to explore is how do we strengthen unity within our marriage? So we are going to look at four ways that we strengthen unity in our marriage. And so the first one, it's really easy. It's face reality. So we are different, and you may not know this, but you are married to a sinner, and you are a sinner. So that does cause problems in the marriage. So inaction is never a good way to deal with changing conflict in our marriage. So a lot of times I see couples, they don't like to say, oh, we're having issues. They don't like to admit it to other people, and they don't want to admit it to themselves. Not a good way. Inaction is never a good way to deal with conflict in the marriage. You have to deal with it, and you have to admit it to yourself and sometimes to others, which we'll get to that. So the Bible is brutally honest. It's brutally honest that we are sinners, but it also has a lot of grace. So the great thing about the Bible is it gives us both perspectives, and it allows us to face the reality of our sin nature, but it also allows us to have great hope in what the Lord wants us to be. So number one, face reality. Number two, deal honestly with your anger. Okay, anger is a real emotion. So we're going to talk a little bit about anger. So it's never a good idea to deny your feelings of anger. However, we need to look at it for what it is. So let's stop and look at it. So I'm going to camp out right here for a second. I may need to stand up.
Okay.
So here we go. So anger is a different emotion than other emotions. So let's talk about that a little bit. So anger is different because we process it differently, and it's not a primary emotion. I'm going to explain that. So anger is different in that if you are sad and you process the sadness, if I come home and I say to Matt, I feel really sad about this, and I talk to him about my sadness, then it's going to help me feel less sad. But if I come home and I talk to Matt about anger, especially if I feel like I've been wronged by someone, it's not going to make me feel better. It's going to make me feel more angry. So anger is different than other emotions. It's also a secondary emotion. So primary emotions are sadness, hurt, or even happiness, emotions that we like. But anger always has something underneath it. It's like an umbrella. So if you are feeling angry, then there's probably something underneath it, like disappointment or hurt or maybe surprise or embarrassment. So you need to look at what you're actually feeling instead of focusing totally on that anger. So we also need to look at why we get angry. So you never get angry at the event that is happening in the moment. Now, a lot of times we think, well, that person made me angry, or that person made me angry, or my husband made me angry. No, people cannot make you angry. Ah, you're like, oh, yeah, right, whatever. No, it's how you perceive the event. So it's how you perceive the event. Because someone can come up and say something to me that I don't perceive to be true, and I'm like, eh, that's no big deal. But if they say something to me that touches on something that's really hard in my life or an insecurity in my life, then I'm probably going to have a pretty big emotional reaction to it. And that probably is going to be angry, because that's usually our go-to emotion, is anger. Anger feels like it's more acceptable to some extent than sadness. So it doesn't look as weak, if that makes sense. So our perceived meaning of event. Now, where does that come from? It comes from those events that have happened in your life. It comes from what you view safety as. It comes from a whole lot of things that happened even before you met your spouse. And so what happens is we develop these negative beliefs we have about ourselves, and then we form protection around ourselves so we won't get hurt again. And that comes into our marriage. And it comes into our marriage in how we communicate to each other. And so I'm going to go over a couple of things that we do to protect ourselves that we believe are protection, but it actually is destruction. So first off, criticism. So criticism is an attack on your spouse at the core of their character. Criticism is never a good thing in a marriage. It breaks down the relationship. Contempt. Now, contempt is really, really hard in a marriage. It actually, so this is from a researcher. It's a couple. It's Gottman, if you want to look it up. I'm going over four things that are really hard in a marriage. So contempt. If you have contempt in your marriage, there's probably about an 85% chance, if you don't do anything about it, that you're going to get a divorce. Yeah. Yeah, wow, I heard that. Wow, yes. So, and that is research-based. So it's been researched over and over again. So criticism attacks your spouse's character, but contempt assumes a position of moral superiority over them. Words are hard. So it's thinking that you are superior over them. Usually that's based on your insecurities, but it comes out as looking as if you are superior over them. Defensiveness. So when we feel unjustly accused, we get defensive. I mean, we've all done that, right? I mean, I've done that. Like, Matt will come home and he'll ask me something, and something in me like rises up, and I'm like, "What? I can't believe you did that. I can't believe you accused me of that." And then I get defensive. Well, I didn't have time to do that today. You need to understand how busy I am. Do you not understand that? And then he's like, whoa, where did that come? I was just asking a question. So defensiveness is when we feel unjustly accused. We fish for excuses, or sometimes we play an innocent victim. So if you do that, you do that so your spouse will back off from you, so you can get out of it. And then the last one is stonewalling. We also call this shutting down. Now, it takes a whole lot to get to this point, but a lot of people do. They shut down. And that actually is a biological thing that your brain does. It just shuts down so you don't have to deal with what is going on in the moment. You can look busy, or you can maybe get sleepy. If you've ever been in a stressful, something stressful, and you start feeling sleepy, it's actually your body trying to protect you. It's not always a good thing, but it is your body trying to protect you. So you can recognize it as that. So these things we think are going to protect us. Well, I don't think consciously we do, but they actually destroy our marriage, and they are not good ways of communicating. So let's try to see how we can act instead of that. Okay, so you need to choose what's important to be angry about. Not everything is important to be angry about. I mean, there are some things that you can say, you know what, this just isn't important. There are also ways of saying, hey, you know what, I know Matt is on my side. So when he says something to me, he's not out to get me. And so I can kind of manage the inside of me, and so I don't feel so defensive towards him. And so figure out what you need to be angry about. There's big things and there's little things. And usually it's the little things that gets us in our marriage. It actually talks about that in the Song of Solomon. It talks about it's the little foxes that get us in the marriage. So do not let anger fester. It's important to ask yourself, what story am I telling myself? Instead of staying in that anger. Like I told you, the anger is... It grows. The longer you stay in it, it grows, and it gets festering, and it turns to bitterness. That's not helpful. Also, deal with anger quickly. Okay, so let's talk about this. Be able to admit when you're wrong. It's okay to be wrong. It doesn't mean anything about you. It actually means you're strong if you could admit you're wrong. So admit when you're wrong. That goes a long way. Also, understand that it's good sometimes to take a time out. So if you are fighting and it's getting really heated, your heart rate goes up. And once your heart rate goes up above 100, unless you're working out, so if it goes up in anger above 100, actually your IQ starts dropping. Yeah. Yeah, it does. About 40 points. So it takes about 20 minutes for you to re-regulate. And so go and say, hey, we just need a timeout in this, because I can feel it just dropping here. And so just walk away, go do something else, whatever helps you feel better, and gets it so you can actually talk to your spouse from here instead of here. Because when you're talking here, this is where the emotions are held, and that's where all the hard things are held. And you don't want to talk from there. You want to be able to talk from the front of your brain, your frontal cortex. So let everything calm down, and then you can go back and talk to your spouse. Remember, the emotions are visitors. So they will come and they will visit. These are emotions we like, and emotions that we don't like. So happiness, I'm sorry, it's a visitor. It will come and it will go. But so is anger, so is sadness. They're all visitors. So you may be very, very angry with your husband or wife. Like, at 8 o'clock in the morning, but by 8:15, you may be fine. So let them come and let them go. Don't let them come and take camp, you know, especially those visitors you don't like. Don't let them come into the house. You know, you wouldn't let someone you don't like into your house to stay, and I mean, if you could help it. So you're going to say, hey, you know, I'm busy right now. I got to go somewhere else. So go ahead and let them pass and understand that they will pass. You may be angry now, but they will pass. And then what about anger at night? So a lot of times we say that don't let the sun go down on your anger. I don't think that's meaning that you need to fight until 2 o'clock in the morning. That's not helpful. That is not helpful at all. And this is why it is not helpful. When you go to sleep at night, your brain actually starts resetting and processing. And so have you ever gone to bed and you were really worried about something or you were upset about something? You go to sleep and you get a good night's sleep. Let's say you get a good night's sleep. And then you wake up the next day and you're like, hey, I can see this more clearly. It's because your brain is actually reset. Sleep is really important. So what you have to do, instead of just saying, hey, we're just not going to talk about it at all, say, hey, you know what, we are angry right now, and we're probably not going to resolve it. If we fight until 2 o'clock in the morning, that's not going to be helpful. It's just not. I can promise you it will not. And so I love you. This is what we do. I love you.
We fought before at night?
Yeah. Well, every once in a while. Yeah. Maybe. It's of course not your fault. but you know, hey, I love you. I love you. Let's just go to bed. Let's sleep on it, and then we can talk about it tomorrow. So you don't push it away never to talk about it again. But you let it, you go to sleep, let your brain reset a little bit, get some coffee the next day, and then
have
you
a quiet time.
Spend some time with God. And then you can come back and you can talk about it. Have a time that you can actually talk about it from the frontal cortex, not from the limbic system where all those big emotions are held. So you want to talk right here. You want your IQ to be as high as it can possibly be. You don't want it to be dropping while you're talking. And then if you need to, you know, take a break. It's okay. You can take a break.
They didn't teach us that in seminary, by the way, as a pastor. I was like, what? And go ahead. Sorry.
So, so that's all about anger. Okay, so then let's look at number three. Communicate in ways that are wholesome. So even when you're fighting, you can actually communicate in ways that are wholesome. Let's talk about that. Wholesomeness is other-focused. So you got to consider what your goal is. You can win that battle. I say you can, but is it going to be worth it? Is it going to be worth it to your relationship? Probably not. It's probably not going to be worth it. And you probably really won't feel that great about it. I don't know. You may for the moment. But then it's going to come back around. So let your comments to your spouse be helpful. You don't have to say everything that's on your mind. You really don't. You really don't. And so let them be helpful, not hurtful. And look at the goal. The goal is for you to resolve this to make your relationship stronger. Conflict isn't bad, you just need to be able to do it well. And so wholesome communication is walking in the Spirit. It's walking Spirit-led. So can I go over? I know we're a little bit behind. Okay, so I'm going to give you eight C's. Eight C's, okay? And I'm just going to go through them real quickly. So walking Spirit-led, you walk in calmness. So calmness is, regardless of the circumstances, you react in a less extreme or automatic way. You walk in clarity, the ability to perceive situations accurately without your negative cognitions distorting it. That's not easy. You walk in curiosity, a strong desire to learn something new about your spouse and their experience. You walk in compassion, to be open, appreciative, and empathetic with your spouse, not wanting to fix them. You walk in confidence, staying fully present in the current situation, having the ability not to allow the past to spill into the present. You walk in courage, recognizing that the damage and our own pain it actually causes our negative cognitions, and it causes distortions in our relationship and in how we view things. We walk in creativity, the ability to learn and find solutions to problems together, and connectedness. We are all built for connectedness. So this is the ability to relax your defenses to be a part of a larger calling. And this is the calling that God has given you, to be connected with your spouse in a helpful way. And number four, run to your resources. So like Matt said, I run the counseling center here. You have a great resource in that. We do community groups. Be open and honest with people around you. You may need to sit down with someone and say, hey, we need help with this. Resist the lies of the enemy, because the enemy will lie to you and will say, oh, well, that person is against you. Oh, well, it would be better off if. That's not truth. That's not truth. And then humbly admit your ongoing struggles. It's okay. It's okay that you struggle. We all struggle. Marriage is not easy, and just living is not easy. We all struggle. So, and that's okay.
I want to do this, just talking about the differences and how we work through that. I want you to take just a couple of minutes. Go to page 20 in your discussion questions in your book, and just briefly, there's two questions there. One of them is, what differences have caused the most friction between you? And what are the differences you have come to appreciate the most? Just take a few minutes and just speak to each other about that. It looks like some good conversations are happening. Some of you are smiling and laughing. Some of you look very serious. Again, our goal with this group discussion questions are for those is not to get you arguing with each other. It's just at least open up and start sharing. And listen, it's actually good, like Krista said. Sometimes conflict is good, and if you need to bring some of those things out and talk about it more, that's good. So we encourage you to take home those questions, and this week start looking at some of those, and even the ones that are talking about the differences, and saying, hey, let's look at our differences. Let's try to see how we can honor God through our differences. Well, let's do this. We're going to take the next 20 minutes we have here and focus on commitment number 6. And it says, we will work to protect our marriage. Protect our marriage. And before we get into all of that, I just think about that statement. One of the reasons Krista and I, my heart's desire, and obviously the staff at all the pastors at Hickory Grove, our desire is to see marriages, as Rick said earlier, just that are strong and that honor God and that can build a healthy church. And so I like to look at marriage sometimes and thinking about protecting our marriage and look at it and say, and get real serious and say, guys, we've got to do whatever we can to protect our marriages. I mean, just a simple statement, but it has so much meaning behind it and so much power behind it. Because I think a lot of times today in our society, what we do is we don't work at our marriages because it's so easy to give up in our marriages. It's so easy to drift along. It's so easy in our marriages to get caught into sin. And what happens is our marriages just start to crumble. And our marriages in our churches, unfortunately, just start just to look so different than what God's original design was for marriages. So it is about protecting. It's about saying, God, what can we do to save this marriage? What can we do to... And if your marriage, you're like, hey, I'm here because my marriage is doing actually pretty good. We just want to learn more. That's great, too. You want to say, okay, what can we do to continue to grow our marriage and protect our marriage? So this is what we're going to look at real quick, just for a few minutes. That is this. First of all, just grace. And that's what Paul Tripp talks about in the last few chapters, is he goes into just, first of all, looking at grace and saying, you got to have grace. And you've heard that word over and over the last few weeks. Grace, grace, grace. Because a lot of times, because we're not given grace in today's society, a lot of times we feel that pressure, and we feel that in our lives, and we push it in our marriages, and we expect things. And if you do this, I will do this. That's what we're taught in society today. I'll do this if you do this. That's not grace in your marriage, and that's not what Ephesians 5 talks about, as Paul talks about, as we've talked about the last few weeks as well. So grace, just a few statements on grace. And by the way, this is just coming from page 263 in your book. But I'm just going to kind of walk through these really quick. But I want you to hear this, if anything, talking about grace in your marriage. God's grace guarantees that you, in your struggle, will never be alone. God's grace assures you that when you have blown it, there is forgiveness to be found. Grace means that there is strength available when you're weak. Grace assures you that there is wisdom for the moments when you do not know what to do. Grace gives you hope when there seems to be little to be found. Grace enables you to get up, move forward when inside you want to quit or run away. Grace reminds you again and again that you are not alone. So just continue to think about grace in your relationship, in your marriage. And the second thing Paul Tripp talks about is just prayer. So this is what we want to do. We're going to look at, if you got your Bibles, you can turn to this, Matthew 6. It's in your notes there, Matthew 6, verses 9 through 13. I thought it was interesting how Paul Tripp took the Lord's Prayer, and kind of walked through it and said, this is what prayer can do with your marriage and what it does. So number one, I'll kind of walk through these things and walk through the passage. But number one, prayer reminds us that we are not alone. Matthew chapter 6, verse 9 says this. Jesus says, pray then like this. He starts out, our Father in heaven. If you are in Christ, if you're a Christian, you have a heavenly Father. And this is where we have to make sure we understand there is a difference between the heavenly Father that we believe in than our earthly Father. Now, our earthly fathers can have great characteristics, but we know sometimes when you hear the word Father, going back to background, talking about trauma, and Chris talked about trauma, a lot of times when we hear Father, it brings up negative things in our mind. Because you think about, this is how my father treated me, or this is what happened in my life with my father. You can't look at it that way. You look at the Heavenly Father, who is wise, true, faithful, gracious, loving, forgiving, good and kind. So it's a reminder that, hey, we're not alone. Again, it's that whole thing of God is in your marriage. God is with you. And then the second thing is this. Prayer reminds us that God's purpose for your marriage is always bigger than your marriage. It's always bigger than your marriage. And he goes on to say this. He says, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In other words, you're praying to your Father. Father, you're in my marriage, but we need to look at your marriage. And you're praying. You're saying, God, it's so much bigger. It's not just my little world here. And sometimes we think we sometimes get concerned and we're like, there's so much going on in my little world right here. What is God doing right here? Listen, God has a greater plan. God's will is, things are happening that we just don't see. And it's always, God's purpose for your marriage is always bigger. We need to stop trying. We need to stop trying to be sovereign in our marriage. We in our marriage try to set an agenda. Hey, listen, I've done that many a times where I'm like, this is exactly what I want to do. This is how. And now I'm not against planning. I'm a planner. I love to plan. But when we start getting ahead of God and we start saying, God, you know, and we leave God out of the picture and we start saying, this is the plans for my marriage. This is what I want to see happen. We've got to stop doing that. We got to pursue God's agenda together. Third thing is this. Prayer requires us to see ourselves as needy. Prayer requires us to see ourselves as needy. In the scripture, it's just the verse in verse 11 that says, give us this day our daily bread. I mean, we just need to say, you know what? Hey, listen, if we don't pray, if we're not praying, we're basically saying, God, I don't need help. I don't need help. I don't need you. I don't need this. But we need to say we're dependent and we're needy. God, we need you to provide. We need you to give us our daily bread. We need you to do this. We need you to give us the basic necessities of life. Number four, prayer reminds you of God's daily call to give the same grace to your spouse as God has given to you. It says this in verse 12, and forgive us our debts as we have also forgiven our debtors. It's about loving God and loving others. It's about the forgiveness that was given to you, right? We believe that. We believe what Christ did for us. And again, this touches on Ephesians 5. But this is where we say, you know what? My relationship with my spouse is a self-sacrifice. It's It's for the good of another. It's for the good of my spouse. It's me just showing grace and not expecting my spouse to be this, this, and this, and this, and this. And when they mess up, why did you mess up this, this, and this? It's showing that grace. Number five, prayer reminds you that your biggest marital... This is interesting here. I mean, this just hits me in the face here. Prayer reminds you that your biggest marital struggles exist inside, not outside of you. And the verse is this: lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. A lot of times we're looking at our marriage and we're looking around us saying, look at all the issues here, and even pointing to our spouse and saying, look at the issues, look what's happening. We point. It's really about what's happening inside. It's that daily struggle of saying, God, I want to walk in holiness, and I've got the sin in my life. I want to walk in holiness, though. Prayer requires us to admit who we really are. I mean, again, how many times, I know Pastor Clint said this, Kyler said this, Krista said this, and I'm saying this. We are sinners, and we need God's grace, and we need that with each other. We need rescue and protection. And what that helps us to do is stop pointing and doing the blame game to our spouses. You know what I'm saying? Y'all know what I'm saying? It's like, you know, even if you're not doing this to your spouse and you're looking at, because if you did that, you probably, I don't know, some of you might, yeah, that might not be a good situation if you're going, ah. But listen, a lot of times inside we're going, you know what, that's his fault, that's her fault. What is she doing? Why is she doing this? Why can't she do this? Why can't he do this right? And it's time for us to look and say, hey, it's about pointing right here and saying, what do I need to do? What do I need to change? So here's the bottom line. And this is how we're going to wrap up. And we're going to take the last 10 minutes and do something that I really prayed through. And I said, I think this is what we need to do tonight. But before we do that, it all goes back to this. It is getting this vertical relationship with God right and correct before you start dealing with your spouse. Okay? I mean, if you kind of read, as you read through Paul Tripp's book, it just continues to pull out. Everything he's talking about, you just see that over and over as he's talking about that. He's saying, listen, you got to do this. You got to put God first, and you got to walk through this. So just a few things, let me just say this. And this is actually on page 303 if you just want to write this down. This is some things he says, but I'm just going to kind of walk through these real quick. And I'm going to say it like this: with God first, vertical relationship, God first. With God first, you live with his plans and purposes in view. With God first, you live thankfully. With God first, you don't shrink your world down to the size of your wants, needs, and feelings. With God first, you don't try to do his job. With God first, you want to give to others the same grace you received. With God first, people and things are in the right place. With God first, you celebrate his work in your spouse. And with God first, you don't live in fear. I mean, there's probably more things we could just start listing and saying, with God first. And that's, if anything, out of these things, and I've enjoyed reading through this book. We've enjoyed reading through this book and just pulling stuff out and looking at these six commitments. So we encourage you to continue to walk through this. If you haven't finished the book, get together, sit down with each other and start walking through this some more. Answer some of these questions. Tough questions. It's hard sometimes for us to sit down, right? It's easy to sit down in front of Netflix and watch a movie. It's easy to sit down in front of any of that stuff and watch a movie together. That's great, right? Well, there's some time. Nothing's wrong with that, by the way. You can do that. But there's times where you say, hey, we just need to talk through some stuff. And we don't need to let it happen a year down the road or 2 years down the road. We need to continue to communicate. Here's how we want to end tonight. Now, this might be a little bit awkward for some of you, and that's okay. We're going to pray. We're going to spend some time praying. That's how we're going to close out tonight. And the way we're going to do this is we're going to pair up with your spouse, and we're just going to get all over anywhere in this room you can find a little spot where you and your spouse can sit there. And I'm going to lead you through some prayer points. Now listen, if you're like, oh my goodness, what did Matt just say? We're going to pray. If you've never prayed with your spouse, that's okay. This is not, and have grace with each other and say, hey, listen, maybe we've never done this, but this is a good time to do it. And listen, when you pray with each other, I'm going to lead you through some prayer prompts. Again, don't feel like, man, my prayer life is just not where it should be, so I don't know how to pray. We're going to lead you through that. And the awesome thing is God, in the middle of your marriage, He understands and He's good with that. This is just us, you, as a couple, humbly coming together and say, hey, we're going to walk through this. So what we're going to walk through is actually the commitments here. And there, if you look at your book here, in the last page, let's see, page 23, it's the back cover. We're going to take two at a time. So I'll just, when we split up here, I'm just going to say, hey, we're going to focus on these first two and give you a minute or two just to pray with each other, okay? We'll move on to the next two, and we'll be through for the night, okay? So right now, find anywhere in this room. Don't go out of this room, but take a chair. Take your chairs. You can move your chairs because we're done after this. You can take your chairs wherever. You can stay right there if you want to. But let's move into a place of prayer right now. All right, the first thing we're going to do is this. And I'm going to be quiet here in a second, but I'm just going to kind of lead you. Take confession and forgiveness. Think about that. If you remember a couple weeks ago, we talked about the importance of confession and forgiveness. So just think about your relationship. Think about your marriage and say, man, how much is that involved? If anything, you're just confessing. God, we need this in our marriage. And that's as simple as it can be, is just that's what we need in our marriage. The second thing that we're going to pray through right now is the pulling weeds and planting seeds. So maybe there's something that you're like, oh yeah, we talked about that a couple weeks ago. Just pray through that just a minute or two, and then I'll move us to the next thing. So take those first two commitments and pray with each other. All right, just keep in the spirit of prayer. I want you to move to trust. And that's just praying about building a steady bond of trust, working together for that. That's a commitment. And then just your love for each other, a real relationship of love, something you'll commit to, real love. Pray for those two things now, trust and love for each other. The last two things, keep it in the spirit of prayer. Just praying through and your differences and dealing with those differences with appreciation and grace. Just learning that. And then the last thing is just your love for God, just protecting your marriage. Just finish it out with those two things. Just your love for God and your desire to protect your marriage. Listen, if you've never prayed with your spouse, again, look at this as, hey, this is a great opportunity to start doing this more. And it's not easy sometimes. Sometimes we don't know what to say when we pray with each other, but it's a good thing to do, even if it's a simple prayers together. Maybe something more than the meal, which is still good to do if you pray over a meal, but to get together and do that. I hope this has been encouraging to you guys, just taking just the last few weeks and just looking at this book. And these six commitments, and we pray that through this, God is honored, and God will be honored through our marriages. Let me pray, and we'll be dismissed. Father in heaven, we come to you as our heavenly Father. And Lord, I pray tonight that each couple in here, whether they're getting ready to get married or they've been married for years, that we will make commitments daily as we've studied them, commitments that honor you and put you first and that glorify you. God, I pray for these couples, that each one of them, that God, no matter what they're facing, what they're gonna face, that we will hold on to your promises from your word, that you are with them. You are with them in everything they face. And so, Lord, through that, I pray that they will seek you daily. And God, through that, you will empower us to live with each other and to live and proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ through our marriages. We love you and thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.